Silke Hense. I would like to introduce Silke Hense briefly. She is now a professor of Latin American history at the University of Cologne since April of this year, April 21. Before, she was a professor of non-European history at the University of Münster. And I would like to mention her main research focuses. She concentrates, for example, on governance in the colonial era and after independence. She also focuses on migration, racism, and violence. Her regional expertise lies in Mexico, the United States, and the Cono Sur. And I would like to mention some of her recent publications, or her most important publications. For example, El Desarrollo del Federalismo en México, La Élite Política de Oaxaca entre Ciudad, Región y Estado Nacional, entre 1786 to 1835, which was published in 2012. She co-edited a book titled Dinámicas de Inclusión y Exclusión en América Latina, Conceptos y Prácticas de Etnicidad, Ciudadanía y Pertenencia, published in 2015. And Silke is the editor-in-chief of the Jahrbuch für Geschichte Lateinamerikas, the Anuario de Historia de América Latina. Silke, we are very, very happy that you accepted to give this second key lecture here in our conference, which has the title Social Practices of Representation in Early Republican Mexico, and you are invited to take the word. Thank you.
Bueno, muchas gracias, Susanne, por esta presentación, y muchas gracias también por invitarme aquí a esta conferencia. Lo agradezco mucho, es un gran honor. Porque la pregunta era un poco a corto plazo, yo voy a hablar en inglés porque se me hizo más fácil de preparar la ponencia. Entonces, disculpen, yo en la mesa yo tenía miedo. Bueno, todos están hablando en español y yo no, pero me di cuenta que algunos de ustedes en la mañana también hablaron en inglés, entonces espero que sea okay. Let me start with a quote. The call for the Constituent Congress will be made freely by the Congress that was dissolved, because if it is not done by the Congress, who does it? If the present government of Mexico decides on the convocation, this measure carries with it the character of nullity, since in the absence of constituent laws establishing the manner of representing the people, no power is vested with the right to dictate the provisions that form the fundamental principle from which those should emanate. It is therefore necessary to revert to those that are known and practiced in these cases, namely, the convocation should be issued by what comes closest to the expression of the general will. Unquote. In this explanation, the subscribing generals Guadalupe Victoria and José Antonio López de Santa Anna advised how to proceed after the plan of Casamata and left the emperor Agustín de Iturbide without military support in February 1822. I'm sorry, 1823, I should know it. Casamata called for the reinstitution of the National Congress, which Iturbide had dissolved at the end of 1822. The plan or pronunciamiento opened the door to much broader change in Mexico's political system. The country was to be constituted as a republic in 1824. The groundwork for this was laid in a turbulent previous year. The declaration cited exemplifies the problems political actors found themselves confronted with during the difficult process of state building after independence. A completely new order had to be determined, new institutions had to be built, and their legitimacy had to be established. In addition, the instructions highlight two prominent political concepts of the time, the general will and representation. The growing importance of these notions in the decades following Mexican independence was closely linked to the changes underway in Spanish America, where the concept of public opinion had gained greater importance as a source for the legitimization of politics since it was invented in the 18th century. In Mexico, public opinion and the notion of the general will became closely connected to the rise of a new political procedure, the pronunciamiento. Although this political practice was not a Mexican invention, it achieved a prominence here that it did not have elsewhere, even in Spain, where the 1820 revolt of Colonel Rafael Riego against the absolutist monarch is considered to have been the first pronunciamiento. The first genuine Mexican pronunciamiento came only a year later with the plan of Iguala, declaring independence. In what follows, I intend to show that the political events of 1823 laid the foundation for pronunciamientos to become an informal institution that was relevant throughout the 19th century, as is manifest in the mere number of at least 1,500 pronunciamientos occurring between 1821 and 1871. In contrast to recent historiography on pronunciamientos, I will argue that they were social acts in which the representation of the general or popular will was performed and turned into a lived experience for the participants. Usually, pronunciamientos are defined as a mixture of violent rebellion and petition of the authorities, that is, as forceful negotiations. Whereas the forceful side of the phenomenon is often emphasized in historiography, here the negotiating side will take center stage because, to my understanding, this was much more important in the early years of independence. Pronunciamientos involved many different social actors, from official provincial bodies and city councils to ordinary Mexicans or citizens. In 1823, the society of the former viceroyalty of New Spain found itself in a liminal phase in the search for a new social order. At stake were the fundamental values and conditions social life and politics should be based on. This included, among other things, who or what made up the nation and who could have the right to decide on the political order. According to Victor Turner, the period of liminality stands between separation and reincorporation and is characterized by the absence of attributes of the past and of the coming state. For the purpose of this paper, a slightly different conceptualization of liminality is necessary. In the realm of political culture, the past seldom is wiped out completely. For example, the corporate perception of society was an important aspect of Mexico's political culture that persisted after independence. The notion that political actors were not only individual citizens, but also corporate bodies of pueblos, cities, and provinces lived on. Nevertheless, the way to influence politics changed drastically, and the nation, as a general overarching concept, invested with an imagined general will, also gained importance. Pronunciamientos played a decisive role in the dramatic political changes and their rise to an informal but ubiquitous institution was a result of the liminal phase between independence and the promulgation of a republican constitution. along with elections, pronunciamientos took on a mediating function between the government, formal representative bodies, and the citizenry. They emerged as a form of representation through which the one-directional relationship between the ruler and the ruled of the colonial period took on a more dialogical form. Communication between the local, regional, and national levels intensified considerably, and pronunciamientos contributed to what Victor Uribe Urán called an explosion of the public sphere in post-Latin America, in post-independent Latin America. This expansion not only took place in printed public spaces, but also in oral spaces that deserve more attention. Many historians on modernity, representational politics, and democracy take the European and US American cases as a model and compare the experiences in other societies to this arbitrarily set norm. It is more, democracy is a concept that many scholars see as absent from Latin America until very late in the 20th century, and politics after independence in general are considered as flawed. Supposedly, modernity and modern forms of politics emerged in Europe and the US, but not in Latin America. Bernard Baylin, for example, contends in his Atlantic History that Latin American independent states, which entered the age of revolution lately, collapsed into despotic fiefdoms and anarchic city-states. Howard Wayarda conveys the absence of democracy in 19th century Latin America, and John Keane finds only a corrupted caudillo democracy. Nevertheless, there is a growing body of scholarship that questions those tropes of Latin American despotism, corruption, and backwardness, and Europe's modernity, republicanism, and democracy. After all, in the mid-19th century, there had been very few republics in Europe, whereas almost all countries in the Americas were republics. In her recent book, Hilda Sabato focuses on sovereignty, citizenship, and elections in order to show that political participation of larger parts of the population than just the often cited elites was common in 19th century Latin America. Elections have been the focus of historiography for some time, and various scholars showed the ample popular participation, that it was common, and that manipulations of elections were not the only characteristic of electoral processes. Furthermore, James Sanders questions the statement that Latin Americans only look to Europe for orientation and shows that many Latin Americans saw their own countries at the forefront of democracy and modernity in the mid-19th century. Finally, recent studies also show that people of all social groups embraced new concepts such as the nation and citizenship during the age of revolution. John Markov emphasizes in his elaboration on democracy as a topic in world history that it was defined at the end of the 17th century as, quote, a form of government in which the people have all authority, unquote. This imprecise definition needed to be put into practice by the creation of institutions that would realize such a notion. My argument here is that in Mexico, the pronunciamiento at its inception after independence was such an institution, people perceived as realizing their sovereignty. Therefore, I understand the investigation of pronunciamientos as a contribution to decentering history, the history of democracy. Contemporaries in Mexico already considered pronunciamientos as one of the two possible ways the population could engage with politics, the other being elections. While the term democracy itself was not commonly used in Mexico at the time, the idea that the general will could legitimize political claims, especially when used against the actions of former government institutions, was very common. That is, many social actors made claims about the proper social order during political conflicts and did so via pronunciamientos. This political practice became so prominent because it fitted the corporate image of society better than elections, which instead conveyed that each individual citizen had the right to equal participation. Pronunciamientos did address political questions and incited public communication that often included the whole country, and thus contributed to Mexican nation building in an unexpected way by contributing to the formation of a nationwide public space. Thus, if conflict and chaos were usually considered important attributes of the era of pronunciamientos, their less obvious constructive effects should also be considered. Furthermore, the events of 1823 show that many pronunciamientos occurred as a response to decisions made by government bodies, especially Congress, or the absence thereof. You will understand that later, I hope. That is, political communication between different parts of the body politic played a crucial role in the formation of the pronunciamiento as a representative practice. The revolutionary process of decolonization involved the search for a republican government, the conflict over whether to install a central or federal system, the rising influence of liberalism, and the concept of citizenship. Ideas about sovereignty, democracy, representation, and the general will circulated in the Atlantic world. The special circumstances in each of the different Atlantic regions led to adaptations and transformations that brought about specific interpretations and new practices. And in Mexico, the pronunciamiento was one such innovation. Let me briefly refer to the political events that led to 1823. Following independence, after a decade-long civil war, constitutional monarchy persisted in Mexico for another year. The emperor, Agustin Iturbide, who had come to the position under dubious circumstances, did not, however, accept the strong position of the legislature as laid down in the still valid constitution of Cádiz, and thus came into conflict with the Constituent Congress on the question of sovereignty. When Iturbide dissolved the Congress and convened a smaller assembly, the Junta Instituyente, General Antonio López de Santa Anna declared against this proceeding in Veracruz in December 1822 and launched a pronunciamiento together with other veterans of the War of Independence. They demanded the nation's rights to be respected by reinstating Congress. Claiming to represent the will of the nation, they also insisted on the introduction of a republican form of government and implicitly threatened violence. When the emperor's troops could not assert themselves, General José Antonio Echavarri, after negotiating with the insurgents, launched the plan of Casamata, which repeated the demand to reconvene the Congress, but did not address the question of the form of government. Support for the plan came from all over the country. In early March 1823, the emperor had no other choice but to reinstate the Congress. He did so, claiming to represent the will of the nation. Nevertheless, he could no longer stay in power and abdicated. The end of Mexico's constitutional monarchy, however, was only the first step toward a federal republic. The country's path to a republican system was shaped by quarrels between the reinstated Congress and many different social actors, among them the corporations representing the provinces, militia units, as well as the national military, but even more so, the ayuntamientos, the representative bodies of cities, towns, and villages. All of them articulated themselves in pronunciamientos on the question of who could represent the nation, and the general will was often a cited notion in the declarations. Pronunciamientos in Mexico have recently gained importance in historiography, as has the history of the early national period in general. The works of Josefina Vázquez and Will Fowler stand out in their analysis. Vázquez is particularly interested in the instrumental effects of pronunciamientos and contends that during the 19th century, only a few of these movements were successful, while even less had political consequences on the national level. Casamata being one of these few that had consequences on for the nation. Therefore, according to Vázquez, pronunciamientos had no lasting impact on political culture. Fowler instead emphasizes the role of pronunciamientos, but he detects a more widespread popular participation only occurring in the 1830s. And therefore, he is more on the forceful side of the definition of pronunciamientos. Both conclusions will be questioned in the following. Starting with Casamata, a plethora of pronunciamientos set the tone for political communication in 1823. I could identify almost 200 of these acts in different national and regional archives, contemporary printed materials, and edited sources such as the minutes of provincial deputations, the forerunners of state congresses. This number contrasts drastically with the two editions of pronunciamientos. The one is called Planes en la Nación Mexicana and was organized by Josefina Vázquez. And the other one is an online database organized by Will Fowler, which is called the Pronunciamiento en Independent Mexico. And these two editions list 3 and 6 pronunciamientos respectively for 1823 versus the almost 200 I could find in the different sources I mentioned. In order to show that these pronunciamientos were not just expressions of personal ambitions for some generals or politicians that led into political chaos and even less coup d'etats, but rather should be understood as a practice of representative politics, I will go into details of the social practices of pronunciamientos as they revolved at the beginning of Republican life in Mexico. Until March 1823, the majority of provinces adhered to the plan of Casamata. In many cases, military and militia units were involved, even taking the first step. The move to adhere to the plan of Casamata was often filled with conflict, as demonstrated, for example, in Zacatecas, where the military declared in favor of the plan, and the provincial deputation followed suit only after heavy disputes. On March 1st, the garrison adhered to the plan of Casamata, declaring to follow the unanimous vote of the nation and proposed that the provincial governor led the movement, or if he was not prepared to do so, that command should fall to the intendant. Nevertheless, both officials refused their support and asked to wait for orders from Mexico or Guadalajara, the latter being the seat of the Capitanía General of Nueva Galicia, the military district Zacatecas belonged to. Both officials were put under house arrest. The following day, a junta consisting of the provincial deputation, the city council of Zacatecas, the parish priest, and some other clerics met with a commission of 7 officers representing the garrison to discuss the matter. Several members of the junta criticized the military's action as premature and an act of violence, not so different from the dissolution of Congress by Iturbide. As the governor, who participated despite his arrest, put it, quote, "In the political sphere, victory comes always with persuasion and never with a sword," unquote. Facing the threat of military force, the junta attempted to avoid making a decision in order to keep emotions low and uphold public order. However, the military refused to back down. A pamphlet published by the garrison stated, quote, "The well-being of the fatherland did not allow us to wait any longer, because if it did not declare its remedy, despotism would soon scorn us," unquote. When a letter from the governor of Guadalajara informed the authorities in Zacatecas about its pronunciamiento for the plan of Casamata, another junta in Zacatecas was convened, this time with a broader participation. The local merchants and miners, employees of the financial administration, and a large number of vecinos, and that meant at the time citizens, joined in. A military commission was invited to the junta again. Its representatives declared they would submit themselves to the civil authorities and accept the plan of Casamata. Following an oath taking by all the corporations present, the decision was celebrated with the ringing of church bells and fusillades. Indeed, the civil authorities had a good reason to celebrate the outcome because they had, to a certain extent, prevailed over military force and managed to persuade the garrison to declare that it never intended to contest civil prevalence and to unconditionally accept its subordination. Even though you might be tempted to see this pronunciamiento as a confirmation that politics in Mexico after the independence were an affair of the military and the elite, I think the two juntas and the participation of several corporations and vecinos and the deliberations give a first hint that things were more complicated. Let me try to underline this point with a description of other pronunciamientos in favor of the plan of Casamata. In Durango, another province in the north, the response to the plan of Casamata unfolded in the following way. First, the local garrison declared its support for the plan and informed the governor. After failing to persuade the colonel in charge to wait for a solution on the national level, the governor convened the provincial deputation. Its members stated that it was necessary to hear the opinion of the corporations, magistrates, and vecinos. So a junta was convened that very day. In his initial statement, the governor reminded the participating corporations of their oath to Iturbide and asked them not to do anything rash, but to wait for the decision from the government in Mexico City. A judge raised concerns about some hidden intention the military leaders responsible for the plan of Casamata might have had, but they were rejected. In the following vote on the plan, the majority opted for its immediate adoption. When the public was asked again if everybody agreed, one participant denied this, but he was interrupted by many people standing at the doors and of the meeting. of the meeting hall. The turmoil only ended when a member of the ecclesiastical council declared the council's support for Casamata. Then the provincial deputation considered the public opinion to be evident, the junta was dissolved, and only the deputation and the city council remained in session until both institutions declared their adherence to Casamata and ordered the decision to be printed and circulated throughout the province. Whereas the garrison of Durango took action first, similar to events in Zacatecas, in contrast to the latter province, no significant conflict arose between the military and civil authorities in Durango. The minutes of the convened junta reveal the broad participation of the citizenry, with deliberations offering the possibility to voice dissent, and therefore demonstrate that the general will was played a prominent role in this debate. The national will played a prominent role also in the internal eastern provinces when Monterrey, the seat of the provincial deputation, declared its adherence to the plan of Casamata. The acta of this pronunciamiento stated that the generals in Veracruz did not anything opposed to the national will, that they had conformed to the common sentiment of all Mexicans, and that the junta in Monterrey knew it was necessary to manifest its will, as all pueblos should do, in order to stop the clash of opinions. Given its proximity to Guatemala, the southern province of Chiapas went a different way. This province received two invitations, one from the former insurgent general Nicolás Bravo, who invited Chiapas to join the plan of Casamata, the other one from General Vicente Filisola, who asked Chiapas to join Guatemala. In order to discuss these offers, a junta of the provincial authorities and vecinos was convened in the provincial capital. This meeting had been announced in the city by posters inviting participation. After the deliberations on the political situation in other provinces, the junta voted to hold elections for its own government in order to maintain provincial unity and to have a functioning executive political body until the National Congress resumed its role as the center of the nation. This decision was laid down in a plan, which was then sent to other provinces. In addition, secret envoys tried to influence public opinion in Tabasco, encouraging the neighboring province to follow Chiapas's lead. General Manuel Rincón, who reported these events to Guadalupe Victoria, reacted also in also sending secret envoys to shape the opinion in Chiapas so that no action would be taken there against the National Congress. This is an interesting case, I think, because it shows a different form of pronunciamientos. The provincial authorities in Chiapas were asked by outside parties to join their side, but instead of doing so, they opted for a third way and then sought support from other provinces. Furthermore, the sending of secret envoys suggests that oral communication on the public, on political questions of the day was common and reached wider circles of the population than printed materials alone could do. But one should also keep in mind that printed materials were often read aloud in the juntas, but also in taverns and public spaces. The examples given show that the plan of Casamata incited political debates in the whole country and involved social actors beyond the elite. The convened juntas deliberated on the political stance to be taken, which was considered to represent the general will. The participation of the important corporations, as well as of individual citizens in the juntas, symbolically conveyed the authority of the people. Furthermore, celebrations and the decision taken involved an even larger part of the population. Let me now come briefly to the role of the National Congress in all this. From the outset, the Congress reinstalled by Iturbide in March 1823 was caught up in a conflict over its further role in national politics and over the question of whether to resume its task of writing a constitution or call for elections for a new constituent assembly. Whereas some provinces supported the call for the convocation of a new Congress as demanded by the plan of Casamata, others favored the re-established Congress. Yet the Congress added to the existing problems by not determining its own role. Deliberations on the questions how to proceed were postponed. A commission was formed to find an answer, but could not reach an unanimous result. Only after rising pressures from all over the country did Congress decide on the question of its role several months later. While Congress did not rule on the matter, a broad debate arose in the public sphere, not limited to political circles in provincial capitals or to written spaces such as newspapers. In San Luis Potosí, also a province in the north, the governor sent the reports of the special commission in Congress along with further materials to the town councils of the province and asked for their opinion in the matter. In Valle de San Francisco, a junta consisting of the town council, clerics, and vecinos was convened, and all the documents were read aloud and discussed. And in the end, the junta voted for the election of a new Congress. Thus, the provincial authorities tried to involve the corporations and the population of the province in the decision. The circulation of the documents and their reading and discussion in an assembly followed the same procedure as a pronunciamiento usually took, even though the term pronunciamiento in this case was not employed. Several provinces joined a junta in Puebla, which declared in favor of elections to a new Congress because it opposed the existing assembly for two reasons, namely the unjust electoral law under which the Congress had been formed in 1821 and the confidence that had been lost in many deputies who had participated in the junta instituyente convened by Iturbide. Even though public opinion seemed to be leaning towards elections, not all provinces reacted negatively to the majority report of the Congressional Commission. Durango and Querétaro, for example, supported the proposition to have the re-established Congress draw a constitution, but wanted to give the final vote to a new constitutional Congress. Anonymous pamphlets circulated in various provinces defending the re-established Congress as the only legitimate power and accused the Junta of Puebla of abusing its position and of wrongly referring to the popular will when demanding a new Congress. The conservative newspaper El Sol took a similar stance, questioning the right of the provincial deputations and municipal councils to ask for the convocation of a new Congress, claiming that the people had not been involved. In addition, the article contended that only a few provinces were promoting elections. Both contentions were wrong, but show what was at stake in the debate. It was the general will and was the concept of representation. Postponing the decision of Congress contributed to the radicalization of political conflict. Congress finally conceded and convened a new legislature after several provinces took further drastic steps on the matter. Guadalajara took the lead. After meetings between the provincial deputation and the city council, the province declared its willingness to accept the existing Congress only for the purpose of convening a new one and refused to obey decisions by the assembly as long as this demand was not fulfilled. Furthermore, the provincial deputation declared for federalism and asked the towns and corporations in the province to approve this form of government. Jaime Olveda considers Luis Quintanar as the leading caudillo behind these moves. Quintanar was undoubtedly an important figure, being part of the provincial elite who held the official post both of governor and commander in Jalisco. Nevertheless, the 139 pronunciamientos supporting the provincial authorities in its quest for a federal republic were more than just compliance with what either the elite or Quintanar wanted the people to do. Every pronunciamiento resulted from the previously described procedure. A junta involving the important corporations and vecinos discussed the matter at hand and made a decision by voting. Symbolically, these juntas taking place in the whole province were important because their outcome could be conceived of as an expression of the general will in the province. This symbolic meaning was reinforced when the provincial authorities had printed the actas of the pronunciamientos, and this was circulated. In San Luis Potosí, one of the provinces invited by Guadalajara to join the federalist movement, a junta composed of the provincial deputation, the city council and of the capital, and many vecinos of all classes met to discuss the matter. The junta declared itself in favor of elections for a new legislature, but remained cautious about joining Guadalajara in its move toward federalism, explaining that a missing center could lead to the dissolution of the country. In addition to Jalisco, which is Guadalajara named itself, the province of Guadalajara named itself Jalisco with federalism. In addition to Jalisco, Yucatan, Oaxaca, and Zacatecas led the movement for a federal republic, declaring their provinces sovereign and beginning to organize their own governments. Again, the decisions were taken in joint meetings of local and regional authorities and corporations, but the proceedings differed according to the situation in each province. In Yucatan, the provincial deputation called for a joint meeting, and the city council of Mérida, members of the provincial administration, electors of the provincial districts who were present in the city, participated in the deliberations alongside officers of the army and militias. It was declared that Yucatan would accept the national government if it was liberal and representative, and if Yucatan's relation to the central government was to be that of a federal republic. In the southern province of Oaxaca, criticism of the central government compared the authorities in Mexico City to those of Spain, complaining that neither the central institutions nor the administrators they sent had any idea of the regional circumstances and were therefore inept to rule the province. When the province declared its independence from Mexico City, it also wanted to maintain a federation with those provinces it did share interests with. The military played an important role in the process, but it was not that it simply imposed itself. A crowd of people had come together on the morning that day, demanding independence and a federal republic. The city council, having been convened by the commander in chief, who was also the governor, so it was his role, wanted to know the opinion of the military and other corporations. When these declared in favor of federalism, a provincial governing junta was established. Oaxaca's declaration for federalism was not supported, though, by the whole province. Tehuantepec on the southern coast and Ometepec in the southwest pronounced against the provincial capital and in favor of Mexico City. The provincial deputation of Zacatecas declared the province a free and federal state after several days of intensive debate among the main corporations and again after closely following events in Jalisco and San Luis Potosí. But unlike the authorities in Jalisco, the provincial deputation in Zacatecas did not ask for the opinion of other towns in the province, which was criticized by Aguas Calientes, one of the few larger towns in Zacatecas. More provinces joined the movement for a federal republic. The eastern interior provinces, the provincial deputation legitimized its decision in favor of federalism, portraying it as the lesser evil, given how many municipal councils had already declared for a federal republic. That is, here, the highest political body of the province only followed decisions already taken in the towns and villages. The pronunciamiento supporting the plan of Casamata in March and April, as well as those for a federal republic in June and July of 1823, show that on the one hand, provincial and local corporations, but also citizens participated in political decision making. On the other hand, the intense communication within and between provinces, as well as between provinces and national authorities, suggests that the decision for a federal republic resulted from an unfolding political conflict that brought together several levels of social actors in search for political order. Regional elites controlling local and provincial corporations were important, no doubt, but other parts of the citizenry played a role beyond that of claqueurs. The reading of documents from different parts of the country, ordered by various institutions and the subsequent deliberations about them, made the citizens part of a public sphere where important questions on the future of the country were negotiated. The idea of citizens bearing arms in order to protect liberty also played an important role here. Thus, the broad participation of militias in the pronunciamientos has to be put into perspective. Furthermore, the intense communication among the provinces made opting for a federal republic a national decision. That is, provinces or provincial elites did not only act out their own interests, they were also part of a broader political movement for federalism, a solution that certainly became more attractive in the midst of congressional stalemate. In mid-June, Congress finally passed a new electoral law. Nevertheless, even this important step did not calm political disturbances, as Congress did not cease making decisions on other political questions. Again, this was also the result of the complex situation and the need to determine things for the convocation that had far-reaching consequences. The law necessarily touched the question of the number of provinces and provincial deputations. In this context, Congress took up a discussion that had begun in 1822 about establishing a provincial deputation in each of the five regions that together formed the Western Interior provinces. In July 1823, Congress decreed the separation of the regions. In Sonora and Sinaloa, which belonged to the Western Interior provinces, opposition arose, and again, pronunciamientos were used to influence a decision taken by the national legislature. In Sinaloa, the town of El Rosario protested against the separation and accused the Congress of assuming powers it did not have because of its merely convocational character. Several towns, villages, and presidios followed suit because the authorities had asked for their opinions. This case is another example of provincial authorities seeking support within their jurisdiction. One final example might suffice to show that the pronunciamiento in its institutionalized form of convoking a junta, the reading and subsequent discussion of documents, and the ultimate declaration of the junta's will on the subject became a pattern in Mexican politics in 1823 and was perceived as part of representational politics. In December, the new Constituent Congress decided to open discussions of the complete draft of the new constitution and simultaneously sent it to the authorities in the provinces. In San Luis Potosí, several ayuntamientos informed the jefe político or governor that they had received the draft and planned to convene a junta of all vecinos in order to discuss it. This was an important deviation from what had happened with the first constitution proclaimed in 1812, still under Spanish rule. Whereas the population learned about the content of the Constitution of Cádiz, which was the 1812 one, only in the ceremonies of its promulgation and swearing an oath upon it, the draft of the Constitution circulated in 1823 before the deliberations in Congress were finished. This conveyed an important symbolic meaning. The Constitution was not simply enacted, but was put under consideration within the country before its promulgation. Thus, it was not imposed on the population from above, but instead a dialogue was offered about it. Thank you very much.
Okay, I start to talk to Mike as the moderator. Thank you so much, Silke, for your talk in this important political development in 19th century Mexico in the genre of pronunciamiento.
Thank you. And I would like to invite for the discussion. I see Peter, Sergio, and Elisa, Eloisa. Yeah. Okay, Peter.
I can do without. Silke, thank you so much for your very inspiring lecture, especially perhaps for a political scientist very much interested in history, but not only for political scientists. I have three very short questions. The first, how would you translate pronunciamiento? I mean, not simply at pronouncement, but I have been asking myself, what has it been? And not just a simple protest, not a coup? Was it a kind of a rebellion? So how would, I don't know. Second question, who were the actors? So if I got it right, there is military participation, but not only military participation, it's also a kind of early civil society, civil participation. How do these actors get together? You, in your last words, you were talking about dialogue. Well, so, and a third question, this seems to have been a phenomenon in 19th century Mexico and Spain. Why these two countries? So is it perhaps only that it's something called pronunciamiento for Mexico and Spain, and in other countries, similar phenomena perhaps have been labeled in another way, or why these two countries?
Yeah, thank you so much, Silke. I will try to follow up the sort of interdisciplinary dialogue already started by Peter. And my first question is quite related to the second question made by Peter. And who were the citizens, actually, is the question. Because I imagine that women were not part of the game, so to say, and also a broad contingent or the broad populations, indigenous populations, for a reason of language, were perhaps not able to participate. Therefore, the question would be who were the actors there? And the second question is more related to your introductory remarks, in which you actually show very convincingly that there are arguments for decentering the history of democracy. I'm, of course, very, very sympathetic to this idea, but my question would be, what would be the best strategy? Perhaps I'm not doing justice to your case, to your studies. It's just a sort of theoretical question, thinking that, okay, you can try to argue Eurocentrism, saying, look, we had also in Latin America similar phenomenon that could be also compared to with the history of democracy in Europe, or they were even better than democracy in Europe. But the other way would be the idea of entangled or interconnected histories, in which you say, you mentioned this also, the circulation of ideas, and therefore, in a post-colonial situation, democracy can only appear with serious limitations. And not to say...
I didn't get the last word, sorry.
Not to say that democracy there was better, but democracy there was also influenced through the situation, the insertion of Latin America into global history as a colony. So not, so to say, not sort of multiple modernities, but entangled modernity would be, in theoretical terms, the answer.
Thank you. ¿Puede ser en español?
Sí.
Bueno, mi pregunta tiene que ver con lo mismo que han mencionado los dos anteriores participantes. Es decir, ¿de quién surgen estos pronunciamientos? Yo tenía la idea, que cambia ahora un poco con la presentación, de que eran expresiones de una élite ilustrada que realmente representa un porcentaje minimísimo de la población. Veo, digamos, ahora que vienen de diferentes partes del país, mencionaba Durango, mencionaba Chiapas, y que incluso se habla de corporaciones. Entonces, bueno, esto abriría un poquito el espectro de los autores. Por otra parte, también noto que algunos de estos pronunciamientos eran en apoyo al plan de Casamata. Para la etapa de la reforma, por ejemplo, se han estudiado más los pronunciamientos conservadores contra leyes liberales. No conocía yo pronunciamientos que apoyaran las leyes liberales. Ahora, para fines de siglo, hay algunos pronunciamientos que me parece que no estarían al principio del siglo, de pueblos indígenas. Entonces estaría ampliando ya el espectro de participantes. Y entonces aquí lo que me llamaría la atención es la correlación con la prensa, porque al parecer ya a fines de siglo, actores más ilustrados ya no estarían recurriendo a este pronunciamiento, sino los pueblos. Es decir, ya en ese momento, esto sería una vía más tradicional de expresión, conservadores y pueblos, frente a una prensa que podría llegar a más lectores. Y todas estas inquietudes tienen que ver con esto, con pronunciamiento, alcance de opinión pública en diferentes momentos. Gracias.
So thank you, Elisa. So we make a first round, and
okay.
Then we have a second round.
Okay, thank you very much for all the questions. There are many of them. I hope I can address at least most of them. I just start chronologically. I think the translation of pronunciamiento is quite difficult because it is an multifaceted phenomenon. But it is, and this is what I wanted to show here, that it is definitely what, not what it is supposed to be at the end of the 19th century, a coup d'etat. And you, if you look for pronunciamiento in Wikipedia or wherever in a dictionary, you find a coup d'etat. But it's not. It was not in this situation, and it was for a longer time period. This is why I refer to so many pronunciamientos also in this talk, because I wanted to show that there was a variation and different ways how a pronunciamiento could come to an end. So I would probably in this moment call it oftentimes it was the declaration in the perception of the people who pronounced. It was a declaration of what they thought was proper to do in this political question they had at hand. And it was not about their own situation. It was not, we are poor, we need water or whatever. You know, it was just, we participate in the discussion what the country should look like. And we are citizens and we participate in the future of the nation. And I think that this is very important. And I cited literature that is concerned with the change after the Constitution of Cádiz in 1812 was promulgated in Pueblos de Indios, so-called, which were ended with the Constitution of Cádiz. And this literature shows that even indigenous people sometimes not knowing to read Spanish, but they adopted very fast the concept of citizenship and used it for their own purposes. And they claimed to be citizens and that they had rights as citizens. And I think this is important to see also here in the pronunciamientos. These people who participated, I think they, many of them did so because they saw themselves as the sovereign, as part of the sovereign, the nation, citizens, and that they could participate for that and that they should participate in the decisions. And this also, this already gets to your second question and what Sergio also mentioned. So I think the question of who were the actors is very difficult to answer in just one sentence. I mean, there were many different actors, and there were pronunciamientos that were literally only incited by generals, only military involved, you know. But in more cases, in many more cases, it was a different thing. And this is what I try to explain here, that in very many cases, the constituted bodies, elected ayuntamientos of the city councils and elected provincial deputations were very important in these proceedings. So they themselves were representational institutions. It was not, and electoral rights at the beginning of independence, as in many other Latin American countries, was much broader than it was in Europe, for example. Women didn't have the right, but the male grown-up population did have the right to vote. And they consider, as I said, they considered themselves citizens. And so I think this is important to see. And perhaps I could take in the pronunciamientos of indigenous people in later times. Actually, I'm not sure if it wouldn't be possible to find declarations in 1823 in one or another local or regional archive. In fact, I've been in three regional archives, but I think in other regions it might be different. And so this is one thing. And interestingly, again, referring to women, there are also, it's only one we know until today, but there has also been a pronunciamiento by women declaring themselves as women in the 1830s. But this is, well, this is just one document up to now. So I don't know how far this can take us. But when I tried to find information on this, reading the literature on elections in the 19th century in France or in other European countries. And this research sometimes shows that women did participate, but not in voting, but in being at the place and discussing and shouting and whatever. So I looked for documentation for this. Until now, I couldn't find it, but I wouldn't say that it's not there. So probably we should have a closer look at this too. At least Congress, for example, debated of who could participate, who could watch the deliberations, and they explicitly excluded women in a moment when the building still didn't allow to separate men and women. But this also means that when the building would have been changed, that they would allow women as visitors of their deliberations. So I think there could be found more than we did until now. And you also asked, and this is probably also connected to the indigenous people about language. In many villages, there was at least one person who understood Spanish and could translate into the language, the local language. And this is, I think, what often happened. I did some research about the promulgation of the Constitution of Cádiz, and there you can see it, that parts of the Constitution were translated into the respective local language, and people were informed about these parts by these translations that were read aloud in public juntas. So I think it's a little bit more complicated than usually told, the story of who had the possibility to participate in political decision making. And of course, it's not that I'm saying that the humble villagers in the end dominated the decisions. No, of course not. But I'm also questioning the picture that only 1 or 2% of the Mexican population, the elite, had an influence in what was happening. I think that the situation was difficult enough after independence, not knowing what a kind of society should be built and how to do that and how to legitimize it in front of the people. I mean, they had fought for 11 years, and all the people were touched by the war of independence, and they did not say, somebody says me I have to do this or that, but they had their own reasons to participate in the fight. And I'm sure they wouldn't have said, now we are independent, and some general or some elite member tells me what to do, and they would have done if they didn't have the idea that it was what they also considered the right thing to do. So, and I think this liminality of the situation also played an important role in the fact that the pronunciamiento at the beginning of the Republican era was something very different from a coup d'etat. So now I have to, you mentioned interconnected history. This is what I tried to mention when I talked about the Atlantic revolutions. And of course, concepts were circulating and didn't stop at the border of what was still not really clear which borders we were talking about for Mexico at that moment. As I said about Chiapas, it wasn't clear if it would go with the Central American provinces or stay with Mexico. And so, yes, it's definitely interconnected history. And I would say it would be very interesting to search for influences of what happened in Latin America in other parts of the world. But as I'm a Latin American historian, I haven't done so far. Perhaps I should do now. Because we heard archives often are still closed and less accessible, so I could probably do this in Germany, even though or in other European countries. Even though I would think that it might be difficult to find these hints, these influences, because Europeans at the time thought that they had the the proper thinking about what to do in politics and not Latin Americans. So I'm kind of, I don't know if it would really be possible, but still I think to show that the picture that Latin America, in Latin America, democratic or representational forms of politics were completely absent is wrong. And this is a first step. My paper was a first step to show that in this case, others did it that I mentioned in other cases. So this is just, for the moment, this is what I could do, I would say. So I hope I did more or less answer to everybody.
We still have some questions. I see two more questions in the public. Two more in the public, and I don't know if we have a question online. Okay, so I would have a third question. So the next is Oswaldo, please.
Okay, thank you very much. If you look at the early 19th century Argentina, we find similar political manifesto than pronunciamientos. We call it pactos or pact. There were these political bosses, caudillos, or military men that are the head, visible heads of these pacts, but also the historiography showing sort of a social basis of these political manifestos. Beyond the concrete and immediate political impact of these pacts, eventually, these were recognized as a constitutional background. In the 1853 Argentinian Constitution, the introduction explicitly talked about these pacts as a background of the constitutional way of organizing Argentina. I'm wondering if these pronunciamientos found the same, in quotation mark, recognition at the constitutional level. For example, the 1824 or 1857 constitutions mentions how these pronunciamientos or simply the political ideas that came along with this were part of the general background, or there is an explicit recognition of the pronunciamientos as a political instrument and a legal form of a background for the constitutional organization of the country in the case of Mexico. Thank you.
Gracias, Silke. Solo quisiera abonar algo. Y posiblemente tenga que ver con el tema este de las interconexiones y el tema de la naciente democracia de la época. Precisamente en el contexto este de Iturbide, Centroamérica se debatía, pasada la independencia, si quedarse como provincias separadas, si quedarse como una sola provincia o si anexarse a México. En ese contexto es que figura aquí Iturbide y el envío de tropas para sojuzgar precisamente a San Salvador, que se mostraba rebelde a la idea de anexarse a México. Nada más quisiera preguntarte cómo operaba en esos casos esta suerte de principio democrático cuando existía, por el contrario, resistencia, cuando al parecer la figura parecía revertirse y lejos de conseguir unir, incitaba a la separación. Es un tema un poco extraño quizás, pero me surge esa duda, ¿verdad?
And Silke, I have also a question. I wonder if these pronunciamientos were all purely political secular, or is there a religious dimension as well? Because independence was conquered in the sign of the Virgin of Guadalupe, no?
Well, thank you again for the questions. I start again chronologically and would like to mention first what I forgot in the last round. It's not only Mexico and Spain where pronunciamientos took place. You mentioned a similar phenomenon in Argentina, and Veronique Iberard, she's working on Venezuela, and she's working on pronunciamientos in Venezuela, and she is supporting that this is not only that it was not only a violent act to force something, so but that it was more of a declaration what I stated here. But this is recent work, so I just heard it in a conference. I can tell more about this. The comparing this to Argentina is a little bit difficult for me, because I think that you have to, this is a very, it's a micro perspective you have to take, and it's difficult to find the documents, and to then you have to read them and everything. So this is something I would rather not like to do, the comparison, even though I'm surprised, and I will talk with a colleague with whom I did discuss these things. He was working on Argentina, and he said there didn't exist any such thing as pronunciamientos in Argentina. So I have to go back to him and tell him, you should look. Were they called pronunciamiento, or did it have a different label?
Ah,
okay, klar. Mm.
Okay.
Yeah.
But the question is that you find a way to the constitution. I don't know if the pronunciamentos is the same.
No, so then I can do the comparison, because the pronunciamiento was an informal institution. Nevertheless, it was very common to use a pronunciamiento if a corporation or somebody wanted to interfere with a political question. And it was not not taken up in other constitutions, in later constitutions in Mexico. It was even more. It was by a part of the elite, at least, it was seen as sublevación, rebellion, not as an act that was legitimate to interfere in politics. So it was it remained informal all the time, even though it was so important. And Ricardo, you are asking for Central America. And actually, I now answering, I lost the, what was it? I'm sorry.
¿Cómo operaba ese gracias. ¿Cómo, qué sucedía? ¿Cómo se reconvertía, se reformulaba ese mecanismo democrático de participación?
I went, people, I mean, the provinces, if a province pronounced, declared a pronunciamiento, not always, the conclusion was that was done what the pronunciamiento said. And so it's not, not always it was violence that stopped a pronunciamiento, but if you didn't get support from other parts of the country or other parts within the province, if it was just a regional affair, then you could just forget about it. So not necessarily needed the military to go in to fight against somebody who pronounced, or a group who, which pronounced, in order to stop pronunciamiento. And with the Central American case, well, I haven't seen the Guatemalan or except this one I mentioned or other documents from the region, but apparently they searched in Guatemala, as Filisola did, for support in other regions in Mexico, as in Chiapas, but it didn't happen anything at the moment because the national government had other problems to solve. So it was just one occurrence in this really turbulent year of 1823. And it was not, I think, or the Mexican government, when it finally constituted and the constitution was promulgated, it was a fact that the Central American provinces did not join the Federal Republic of Mexico. And yeah, I only noted pronunciamiento now. is it, of course there are religious elements you can in many pronunciamientos, and you can see it, for example, that the church or the clerics had in many cases a part. They were invited to the junta as on other corporations. And sometimes you can also find in the wording of the acta written after in the junta or after the junta and published certain references to religion. For example, it becomes very much a problem, the religious part in 1832 and 3, because the Mexican government then promulgated laws, anti-clerical laws, and a lot of people rose and a lot of priests tried to propagate their course and wanted to have this legislation stopped.
I wondered about this. I have two more questions. One in the chat, please.
So there's a question by a participant, online participant, Nana Onohoa-Aruque. She asks, all right, thank you for this wonderful presentation, Professor Silke Hensel. I'm interested in knowing if you have any evidence of participation by formerly enslaved Black people in these declarations in any of the provinces where they lived in the 19th century Mexico. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
And we take Barbara's question as well.
Yeah, Silke, I would come inspired a little bit by Osvaldo's question about Argentina and comparison. It came to my mind whether this pronunciamiento could be seen as a sort of further development of the institution of the Cabildo Abierto. Mm-hmm. Because that
Okay, I don't see more questions, so Silke, it's
okay
to you.
Yeah, thanks again. Concerning the participation of slaves in pronunciamientos, slavery was abolished in 1829 in Mexico, and so far, I haven't seen documents where slaves were mentioned as participants or articulated themselves in the discussion. So on the other hand, there were, I just recently read about a document that slave women wrote in 1822 a letter to Iturbide and claimed that they were citizens and therefore had deserved their freedom. So it was not that this part of the population did not know what was going on politically in the country. And they tried whenever they could, they tried to use the changes to meet their own ends. And so I would to say it is a question of further looking for evidence in the documents. And the idea of Barbara, yes, I would think that's a good point to think of the Cabildo Abierto, but I would also think that it was more than a Cabildo Abierto in the sense that because of the debate on citizenship and who had the right, who was part of the sovereign nation and so forth, that more people usually were taking a part of a pronunciamiento than taking part of the Cabildo Abierto. But this is a hypothesis and this should be verified further.
And I said further, there's no way you.
Yeah, okay, yeah, I agree.
So I don't see more questions, but I think we really want to thank you very, very much, Silke, for this fascinating insight in an ongoing archival research process. It fit very well with our panel in the afternoon, and it's absolutely fascinating. Thank you also for the questions, which led to a very, very interesting discussion and debate. And so, and now we have our, after a long day, we will have now dinner together and we continue our conversations. Thanks a lot again to Silke Hensel for your wonderful talk.
Thank you to you. Thank you.